This lecture is basically for either instructors who are teaching this course or for self-learners who are trying to basically see, you know, how many lectures they should follow and what are the fundamentals about. So, if you listen to this, then you can plan for the course. So, that's where this is, and the Ecosystem Aware Global Supply Chain Management. This is the title of the book that is that has been published already by World Scientific this year. So, and the contents of this lecture are, let's look at the motivation for starting off this, and the ecosystem model, and the GRIP framework, and look at applications, green supply chain design, if possible, and some conclusions. So, what we are going to do is look at the various things. The first lecture is on motivation, that is, how global supply chains have evolved. Supply chain networks have evolved from single owner, vertically integrated networks into globally dispersed, multiple owner company networks. This is a big, big difference. That's because if you look at the supply chains like what Henry Ford had in 1913, or later General Motors and Chrysler and even IBM and Intel and others, all big companies, they are basically are vertically integrated, meaning they can be global, they can be anywhere in the world, but there is only one owner. And the owner is either IBM or Intel or whatever, or GM or something. So it all basically started with the auto companies, because auto industry is the industry of all industries. So, and then the whole thing started in 1913, the assembly line of Henry Ford, which is very famous, where he basically has streamlined all the processes that are involved in the manufacture of the auto, this one, and created an assembly line. That is, he has people at various, one after another, and the parts pass from one to another and they assemble as they go along. So, but then the governance mechanism of the so-called vertical integration came from Alfred Sloan. Alfred Sloan of the General Motors, he was the one who basically gave an organization structure that is efficient to govern this. I mean, Henry Ford was basically is a big inventor of the assembly line, but the governance mechanism of the assembly line, as the product lines and all that, was given by Alfred Sloan. So, but then with the outsourcing, what has happened in apparel, in electronic and other industries, including the auto, this has been globally dispersed or regionally dispersed, but there are multiple owner networks. In the auto, you have the design is done by General Motors or somebody, and or Chrysler or Toyota, but there are several partners. Suppliers who supply the materials against the order from the OEM or the original equipment manufacturer, Toyota, and so on. So, this is the kind of evolution that has happened. Now, when the evolution of the globally dispersed multiple, this one has happened, each company controls the respective nodes and links. Now, if you want to represent this entire supply chain as a graph, then each company, each supplier is a node, each OEM is a node, and so on. And then you can have edges depending on who is supplying to whom. So this is basically a graph, and coordination and collaboration with network partners becomes a necessity. Well, it could be a market-oriented mechanism where you order something and you are paying for it, and so you basically have to follow, but that need not have to happen. So, the coordination and collaboration between people, between the network partners, becomes an absolute necessity. So, when we have got evolved from vertically integrated to global supply chains, there are several factors that come into consideration. So, what are those factors, particularly if it is global? when the supply chain partners are all over the world, some in China, some in India, some in Singapore, and some in the US, and so on, then each country has their own laws. Each country has its own labor laws, its own financial laws, its own currency, and its own universities. So basically, when you are dealing with multiple partners, you are not alone dealing with the company, you are dealing with the company's ecosystem, which means that the resources the company has, the financial interests that the company has to pay, the foreign exchange it has, the government rules, regulations, and what is the kind of logistics infrastructure they have, what is the IT, this one and all that, these basically matter. So that they can affect your supply chain. So there are issues outside of your supply chain which basically are called the investment effort, investment climate affect your supply chain. So what is the state of operational supply chain today? Efforts of stakeholders for the last two decades has resulted in high performance, highly connected and high risk prone supply chains. Now, this is the one that has happened in the sense that since these are globally dispersed and each one is trying to contribute to the other, and they're all connected by internet, they're all connected through logistics suppliers, and people want to imitate the kind of just-in-time the things, even for global supply chains. They don't want to keep the inventory. And these are the kinds of things they wanted, high performance in terms of lead time, cost, and so on. So with the result, they become very highly connected. Highly connected in a sense, people have developed clusters in high performance clusters in countries like China, like in India, and so on, whether it is a service cluster or a manufacturing cluster. But then what happens with all this high connectedness? It becomes high risk. If something happens to a natural disaster strikes a place, and if it has a very big cluster, let it be auto cluster or electronic cluster, then the whole electronic industry or the auto industry in the whole world gets affected. So when people have started doing the globalization and making the supply chains highly connected, well, they basically didn't care for the high risk prone or the fragility of the supply chain because of the high connectedness. And now today, what people do is, because of the high risk, people try to manage the risk as an afterthought. So they have a risk officer and so on in the companies. And lot of times that the global supply chains are getting affected because of some event somewhere in the world, however trivial it is, and the efficiency gets this one. In other words, what when some unforeseen event happens somewhere in the world, like a fire in a supplier's factory, then that supplier is supplying something, some component which is critical, and the whole production gets delayed. So you will lose to your competitors because your competitors are sourcing from some other supplier and so on. So these are the kinds of things that can happen with the global supply chains today, and they're happening. If you look at the literature, the newspapers and so on, like whenever there is a tsunami, last time in 2011, the tsunami, there were a lot of effects of this. So there is a need for the supply chain redesign. So what we are saying is the supply chains were very well designed. After two decades of hard work, and they are well designed, taking into account just the supply chain aspects of this one. In other words, they are worried about the inventory, they are worried about the deliveries, they are worried about the quality of the product and the cost factors and all that. But When it is global and each supplier is affected by their own ecosystems, by factors extraneous to the supply chain, such as political, economic climate, regulations, delivery infrastructure in the locations of the partners, changes in the availability and cost structure of resources, and host of others. Now, is it possible? One thing is to take up into effect all this as an afterthought, like an exceptional event and so on. But then, when an event occurs every day, it will not be an exception anymore. It is a part of your operational procedure. So, when it is affecting your operational procedure, you need to take those things into account and redesign your supply chain. That's what we are trying to do here. So, redesign of the supply chain networks, taking into account all these factors, is a necessity. So, that is the aim of this course. The aim of this course provides us with tools, frameworks to manage globally dispersed manufacturing and service network operations to deal with multiple strategic operational issues, such as outsourcing, green revolution, regulations and tensions with network partners, increased transportation costs and regionalization. You can add a lot of other things like currency fluctuations. You can add piracy. You can add terrorism and all that. So the point is that you have the supply chain, which is well managed, and it has high performance in terms of cost, lead time, and so on. You are able to supply to the customers whatever they want, whenever they want, wherever they want. But if some unforeseen thing happens, then either the quality of the supply of the product suffers, or the lead time suffers, or the cost suffers. Who will pay for the extra cost? The customer or the company? So there are companies, because of the extraneous events, which were closed down, which went into bankruptcy. So, that's where the importance of this course is. And prerequisite for this course is a basic course on supply chain management, because we are not going to deal with the supply demand matching. We are not going to deal with the inventory control and all that. So, we assume that all that is done. But the question is it necessary to study all this to understand these basic requirements? Maybe, may not be. If you have an idea, if you are a supply chain manager doing all this, but you have not done the basic course, but still you can get benefit from this particular course. So let's see. This course is in 5 parts. So the part 1 is introduction to the supply chain networks. So we give an overview in lectures 1 and 2 of the supply chain networks. I mean, this overview is special here. I mean, this overview is useful for following whatever we are doing henceforward in the course in the part 2 to 5. So, we talk of a type of networks. They are global or they are local or they are regional kind of thing that affects, because if they are global, then they are cross countries, you have customs and all that. If they are local, there are no customs. But still there is a transportation. But the transportation is either truck by a train, but it is not ship one. And there are 3 sub networks. There are demand, supply and service networks. In other words, the supply network is from the suppliers to the manufacturers. The demand network is from manufacturers to the retailers, and the service networks is after sales service. Now, these are the 3 sub networks which are important, and 3 dominant business processes are procurement, manufacturing and distribution and retailing. So, we are getting here, giving a higher level view of the supply chain. What are the processes? What are the sub networks, and who are the dominant players? The dominant players are component manufacturers, contract manufacturers, logistics providers, retailers. And dominant themes are lean, total quality management, and outsourcing. So, these basically are the three ones that are called high performance. Why do you outsource? You outsource for cost advantages. You want to reduce your cost. So, the cost of doing outside plus transportation plus everything is cheaper than doing it yourself. Or you may not have the core competency of doing something, but that part is required in your equipment. Like, for example, the Intel processor, you may not have the competence to use the processor. You have the competence to use the processor in your laptop, but you don't have the competence to manufacture that. So that's where you buy it from outside. There is this one. So basically, it gives you an overview of the supply chain courses that people usually give. And we also gave one lecture on Zara, which is a case study on a Spanish fashion retailer, and so on. If one wants to add another case, Flexotronics is a contract manufacturer in electronics. One can add that into this. So basically, these three or four lectures is going to be the introduction and give examples of this. That covers what is the introduction to this course. And then we go into the part two. Part two basically introduces the supply chain ecosystem. So the ecosystem, its definition, there are four constituents to the ecosystem. That is the supply chain, delivery service, infrastructure, resources, and institutions. So usually supply chains are treated in isolation. But they are affected by the resources. For example, for running the supply chain, you need power, water, you need industry clusters. They act as resources to your components and so on. You need transportation, you need ports, infrastructure, and others. You need banks to give you loans, to give you letter of credit, to give loans to your customers. So, basically, the issue is that the resources become an important part of the supply chain, although it is not considered today. Now, any changes in your resources is going to affect your supply chain. Supposing there is increase in the human resource costs, which is happening in China, India, and so on. So, when it happens, the low cost advantage disappears. So, do you still outsource? You have outsourced earlier, went to China, created all the logistics of outsourcing just because it is a low cost affair, but the low cost disappeared, so you still want to do it. So this is the big question that comes in. And there are institutions. Institutions are the governments and social groups. At one point in time, the governments were permitted, they liberalized the economies and so on. Well, things change every day. The politics, economic climate changes. As things change, the institutions or the governments may become protectionist. They may increase the export duties, or then they may decrease the export duties. They may liberalize for some products. They may restrict for some other products. So there are changes that are happening in this, but that is going to affect your supply chain. And also the delivery service infrastructure, it becomes an important thing, and because logistics cost is about 15% of the product. So if you have faster transportation and also efficient transportation, then you decrease that particular cost. So you can look at various factors, and we study in detail for each of these what are the kinds of effects that they have in the supply chain. So we had examples of global manufacturing, modular products, logistics, outsourcing, and regulators, social factors, and all that. We study the food supply chain in detail. And as a case, we suggest Metro Cash and Carry, because it's a Metro Cash and Carry is a German company. It's a wholesaler, and it tried to enter both China and Russia and India. And in China and Russia, it has no problems, but in India, it had a lot of problems. So the institutional arrangements or the laws that they have in a country become very important. They can become stumbling blocks. In case of metro cash and carry, everything is perfect. In other words, it connects between the farmers and the retailers. It is not coming in the way of anybody in this, except some brokers. And it is going to create efficiency in the supply chain. But still, it went against an act called APMC Act, and basically half its business is controlled by that, and they got affected. So before any country gets affected, the institutions and the regulations become very important. And the deregulations cannot be taken for granted because they are political decisions. And also there are cases on Nokia clusters. You know, Nokia has created a big economy for the country. And so Nokia clusters could be a good example where the country has liberalized and it has invited foreign companies to get these electronic clusters, and that has improved the country's this one. It's a positive aspect of this. So when you are looking at the supply chain ecosystem, you can basically look at issues like the supply chain ecosystem and the cases like cash and carry. The learning experience is that you should not ignore the institutions. So whatever products you are going to offer, whatever business models you may have, they have to be consistent with the regulations of the country where you are operating. And they should also be, they should not be against the social aspects of this. And similarly, if a cluster that is created, which involves lot of asset, which is asset intensive, it involves lot of investments by companies, and it has to be, and the return on investment takes long time. And when foreign companies come and invest, it has to have government support. And it has to show that the government, what is the kind of benefits in terms of employment, in terms of the total welfare of the people of the country, and so on. So the both the cases show the positive as well as the negative aspects of the institutions in this case. So there are others. You know, you can look at food supply chain, you could map auto supply chain, and so on. One of the exercises that we suggest here is when you are trying to do this course, if you are working for a company or if you are doing PhD in a university, you can map the ecosystem for your university. You can map the supply chain or value chain if you are doing for a PhD program, or if you are doing a research project. Not all any research, even a research project like a PhD, has a beginning and an end. And whatever this one you have, you can basically bake into various kinds of goals and split them into modules. So that is about this. So we have part one of this course talks about the general supply chain. Part two specifically concentrates on the ecosystem. So at the end of part two, you should be able to map the ecosystem. You should be able to map the ecosystem completely. And then, there are examples in the lecture about the auto, about the food and so on, and also logistics, telecom. So you take any vertical that you have, healthcare, it is possible to map the ecosystem. Then what do you do with the ecosystem? you should be able to do, I mean, following the engineering principles, you should be able to do both analysis and design. So what is the kind of analysis that you could use using this kind of framework? So, in other words, this is the part three, which is a very important thing, because we are trying to do the analysis of using the supply chain ecosystem framework. So there are 16 lectures in this. And first one is about high performance global supply chains. Now, usually the performance of the supply chain, you start with the suppliers, manufacturers, distributors, and retailers. And you can, you usually do either simulation, queuing, or any one of these analytical methods to find out what is the total lead time. And it is random, in other words, because the events are random, you can find out the mean, the distribution of the lead time. You can find out the mean and variable variations of the distribution. So, you always want to have whatever the mean is, you want to minimize the variation. You don't want to have too much of variation in terms of the lead time. And similarly, in terms of the cost, you want to minimize the cost, but you want to have the cost advantage here. So, but the point here is the lead time now depends not just on the manufacturing times and the delivery times between the stakeholders. It depends on when you are going to a customs through a port. It depends on the port authorities. It depends on the customs clearances. And it depends on the papers, because there is a lot of paperwork that is involved when you are doing the customs. There are 180 documents need to be signed. So you have to look at what are the kinds of documents that are needed. If a document is missing, then it gets delayed. So there are times, sometimes on the average, things wait for from 8 hours to 8 days or even 15 days at the ports. Once it is cleared, it has to be loaded onto the ship, and once it comes to the destination, it has to be unloaded and again have to go through the customs. So, you have to consider the customs duties, this one. Another thing is that in terms of the resources, is the labor productivity. Well, some labor are highly productive, some labor are low productive, so it will take more time for some people to do the same task. And also, the, if you want an LCE clearances, the letter of credit, some banks may do it online when you on your mobile. Some banks may take a couple of days. So the issue I'm making, and also the, finally the delivery mechanisms. I mean, in some countries the infrastructure may be bad, the roads may be bad, so for a truck cannot travel more than 40 kilometers an hour, and whereas in some countries it can go up to 200 kilometers an hour. So these differences in the environment or in the ecosystem will affect both your cost as well as your lead time. You have to take these things into consideration when you are doing the so-called lead time or cost estimation. So, this high performance global supply chain, in this lecture we consider these aspects. And of course, there is a risk in the supply chain. We have three lectures on the risk and a metal case. Now, the risk in a supply chain can come from, usually the risk in the literature on supply chains is considered either the supply risk or the logistics risk or financial risk and so on. But I mean, there are papers or research papers or books which talk about there are various kinds of risks that can occur. But is it possible to identify all the risks and which source they are coming from and how to mitigate them? That's what we are going to do in this, in these lectures. Now, given the ecosystem, this one, we have four elements in the ecosystem, and the risk can come from all the four elements. It can come from the supply chain, it can come from the resources, it can come from the institutions, which are government and social, this one, it can come from delivery. Now, in terms of delivery, it can be late deliveries, it can be defective deliveries, it can be piracy. In terms of the governments, governments may suddenly turn protectionist. They may favor their own local companies. And there could be labor strikes, or could be social groups inside can agitate against your company. So, there are several things that can happen. These could be rare events, but they could happen. Whenever they could happen, you should identify and try and mitigate them and see if they can, if you can manage them not to happen. And there are always resource risks. The resource risks are your labor productivity and your financial risk. That is, if the banks have problems, then you get into problems. And also, there is power shortage, water shortage, increase in your foreign exchange or decrease in your foreign exchange value. These are all risks, and the risk could be either deviations, there are small risks which you can manage, or it could be disruptions. In other words, there is a truck failure, it will disrupt your delivery that day, or it could be disasters. There is a natural, a tsunami somewhere, or a thunderstorm which has wiped out the roads, and it will take a month for things to come into normalcy. So, depending on all this, it's needed that you talk about the risk and identify this. Now, people may say, "Well, you know, everything is risky because any product or any service, any human being can get sick and can die or something." But the point is, you should be risk aware. That's the risk awareness is the one that creates, that is created in these lectures. So, if you want to mitigate them or if you want to avoid them, what is the kind of thing, strategies you have? This is like diagnostic tests that a human being goes through. You cannot avoid diseases. You are careful, but you also test whether it's possible to avoid it. So, this is basically the risk mitigation strategies, which are highly important. And of course, the ecosystem framework for innovations. Now, this is an important topic because people think that innovations can happen only either in products or processes. But innovations can come from resources. For example, Google has created a search engine. And it has created a website. So, what are the kinds of things that you have come because of the search engine and also the internet? You have Wikipedia, which is online, which is free. You have search engines where you can search for anything. You have Google Scholar, you can get any paper almost free if you are a researcher. And also, there are several businesses which are built out of the search engines. For example, online advertising. If you want to search for a product, you can search using Google search. So, basically, these resources which come, they create innovations. So, I have given early examples of the recent innovations that have affected. And similarly, the deregulation. From the institutions, which is an innovation. For example, in several places, the airlines got deregulated. You have things like Southwest and others who came into play. And of course, it creates competition for others, but it is the benefit to the people. There is the regulation of telecom. Telecom everywhere in the world was controlled by the government because it links the information. But it is, most of the countries have deregulated the telecommunication, and you can see the effect of that. And also there is technology innovations like the mobile, which has revolutionized all our lives, the TVs and others. So, and there are business model innovations that come out. For example, home delivery is an innovation. You need not have to go somewhere. You can order online and then, you know, pay online and download your ticket. You need not go to the airline office. So, there are several innovations which have come. It need not have to be product process innovations. And there is also need for co-evolution of the innovations. Innovation by itself, for example, containerization didn't take off till big ships were built and then the trucks were able to carry all those big containers and so on. So, any innovation, it has to evolve. So, in our opinion, the co-evolution of the innovations happens through these four elements of the ecosystem. For example, the modularization of the products is an innovation in products that has led to outsourcing. How? It's because you have a modular product which is specified and that can be manufactured anywhere and there is a process which is standardized to manufacture it and there is equipment that you can use. So, you can buy the equipment from say somewhere and use the process, hire somebody and use the technologies to manufacture in your house and supply it to some big company. So, the outsourcing to low cost countries has come from as a result of the modularization of the products. And because of the outsourcing, they have liberalization. Because of the liberalization, there is the logistics. So, several things happened. So, of the co-evolution here. So, the innovations is another important, we spent three lectures on this. And I gave an example of Cemex, which is an example of all the three. It is risk averse and it has lots of innovations of its own. And of course, the governance, which is very important topic. Now, if you look at the world vertically integrated supply chain, I have mentioned that although it was Henry Ford who basically invented the assembly line and which had revolutionized the auto industry and other industries as well. But it was Alfred Sloan who has this governing hierarchical governing structure which came into being. Now we have globally dispersed supply chains, but who is the manager? Who is the boss? Who tells whom? That is missing. So, in our governance chapter, which is highly virginal, we have two lectures and we have also an orchestrator model. I am not saying they are not companies. There are lots of companies which are operating, but the fundamental principles of governance is not taught. So, these four lectures and the example of Li and Fang, which gives these six lectures, are the ones which will give you the total, this one. So, in terms of the what we call the GRIP network, which is the performance, innovation, risk, and governance. Using the ecosystem is fundamental. And basically, if you are doing any of this, I think you should go through all these 16 lectures with the examples. And that will give you a fundamental understanding of what the ecosystem, how useful is the ecosystem. Well, the part four is global redesign. How do you redesign the supply chain? It involves two steps. One is what is called supply chain formation, and second one is the supply chain governance. Now, supply chain formation is basically like collecting all the information about all the people. In other words, you are in auto industry, you require various components. So, you do research and find out which country has high quality suppliers, whom you can trust, who will deliver products on time at low cost to your design. Design is yours and they should manufacture and give it and so on. And of course, in the process, there could be IP theft and all that. But still, you have to collect each of them from India, China, from Vietnam, whatever, all the countries for each component. And you should find out whether what are the kind of equipment they have, in which country they are living, what is the ecosystem of that, and what are the risks that you face if you source from them. So, once you collect all this information for all the components, all the logistics providers and so on, then this is like collecting the base information. That is the supply chain formation stage. Then the next step is you have to, for each order you have, you want to supply say 1 lakh shirts. Of 3 colors, white, blue and red to somewhere in US, and where do you select various things, and at the end you should design it. After design you should outsource, for look for the yarn, get the cotton, get the cutting and then sewing and then ironing and then sending it to the retailer in the US. So, for each of these, you have to select the partners. So, that is the governance mechanism. Governance mechanism is partner selection, coordination, and execution. So, people call this control tower, like in the power systems, as well as in the air traffic control. You have a control tower, which basically gets all the information and manages all the exceptions, if they occur. And we do the green supply chain design. It becomes a very, very important topic. That's because supply chains are responsible for the GHG gases. What is a supply chain? Any product and service that you generate, you use, is behind that there is a supply chain. So, if you want to reduce, have green products, which means you should have a green supply chain. And if you want to have a green service, like transportation, then you should have a green supply chain or a green service chain. So, basically, it becomes very important, green supply chain design. We had 4 lectures, starting with the fundamentals of green, and then use the design, how to select partners, and what are the kind of governance mechanisms. And a green supply chain has for both forward and backward supply chains, because green means less resource usage, recycling, and there is carbon trading or less GHG gases, greenhouse gases and so on. So, all this requires knowledge, and our ecosystem model is fundamental. For the green supply chain, we have the ecosystem map, and based on which you could do the design. So, once you do this, this one, of course, there is the part 5, which is applications. Well, in the applications, we have, in the book, of course, we have only 3. One is the food supply chain and food security. We have 4 lectures on that. This is important, particularly in countries where huge populations and food supply chain is fragmented. And we also talk about food security and how to supply food, how to use ICT technologies to improve the food security. And of course, we did the green supply chain design and smart villages. Now, the big thing here is this, that is your ecosystem framework useful only for supply chains or service chains? The answer is no. It's much more general. You can have ecosystem framework for villages, for cities, for regions, for countries, for universities, and so on. How can this happen? Because you are always talking about the supply chains here. So, the fundamental thing is that if you look at any village or a city, what is a city? What is a village? What is a university? It's a collection of services. A bundle of services is a university. A bundle of services is a village. A bundle of services is a city. So, When you generalize it in this way, and if you look a city or a village or a university as a bundle of services or a hospital, then you can see that you can have the ecosystem. And instead of having one service chain, you have several service chains. And all these service chains are governed by resources, which the university, hospital or village has. It has the institutions, which are regulations. And it also has the delivery mechanisms. And of course, you are dealing with multiple service chains and it becomes more complex. But sure, it is more complex, any village or a city, but it gives you a framework which is orderly and general to design a village. We present the smart villages and cities. And of course, there is a location selection. Location selection problem is if you want to select a supplier, or if you want to select this one, then you have to do the location selection. So there are four applications, and one can have other applications doing this. And these are representative applications where you can use this one. So what we have in the so far is that this gives you a big about the ecosystem and its applications. Well, if you are a researcher, you could get into research areas like social networks and supply chains, transaction cost economies in the ecosystem framework, governance, coordination, control. In other words, these are for a generalized networks. Governance, coordination, control are very important. Green supply chain and carbon trading, orchestrated model for a green supply chains. You know, there are companies like Olam International, which basically are doing well, but they require help. Location selection based on investment climate. Basically, there are all kinds of reports from World Bank and other consultants and so on. But if you follow the ecosystem framework, those reports could be better. Tax integrated global supply chains. How do you manage your supply chain integrating all these factors, ecosystem factors? Is it possible to develop a mathematical model? The answer is yes. But one should remember that when you are doing optimization with the kind of parameters that we have, like resources, governance, and so on, you may not have numbers all the time. You may have opinion, expert opinions. Like, for example, if the governance good, you cannot give a number for this. You can say it is good, it is excellent, and so on. So there could be some subjective this one. So you should have mechanisms or models, either analytical hierarchy process or some others, or the machine learning techniques, where you can use both textual and data, this one, and then do this. And there is a lot of scope for further research and all this, game theory, supply chain coordination, and all that. So there's several scope for further learning. So for example, the five STEM process. If you are a policymaker, what are the kinds of things that you should worry about? There is what is called STEM. People worry about science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. But according to us, our framework, it is STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, regulations, and policies, and management. Management basically comes out of the governance. So these are the four kinds of importance where, you know, there are five forces which basically govern any particular supply chain or a city or something. You should consider all these for innovations as well as for regulations. And of course, you know, what do you say after at the end? What should you ask question? Now, if you want to get a supply chain configuration, given the government regulations, the investment climate, the vertical space, the company has to tread carefully with the right products, services, planning strategies, such as the location, partnership decisions, and business models to succeed. Now, if you go through the whole thing and then the discussions that in the lectures, you will find that this is the summary of all this. In other words, whenever a company wants to start off, what are the products, what are the services, what are the business models that it's going to follow to succeed? You should take into account the government regulations, the investment climate, the vertical space, and also the resources that are available at this one. It may look common sense, but it is not being done. And this one gives you, this course gives you an analytical way of doing those kind of things. The performance models, for example, their queuing and other analytical models, they can be developed for goods flow. The performance models. Models for design of governance mechanisms, you know, there are for partner selection, coordination and scheduling. There are a lot of work that can be done. The risk management and all that. And also, there are mathematical models for orchestration. You know, orchestration is fundamental, but it needs a lot of attention. You know, we have some papers which we started this work some time ago. And multi-tier procurement in this, you know, in other words, the OEMs are buying from suppliers to suppliers to suppliers and so on. So, if you look at the layers of the supply chain, there could be 10 layers, 12 layers and so on. Starting from the raw material till the OEM and so on. But then one can see the risks, you know, if one of the lower tier suppliers poisons something or uses a cheaper material or a cheaper steel, which can affect your aircraft or your automobile. Then ultimately the OEM is the one who is responsible for it. So multi-tier procurement and as a platform becomes important. And similarly, the multi-tier risk management. In other words, the focus of the supply chain is shifting from managing immediate suppliers to managing the entire supply chain network. So, smart networks and buildings. You know, the service networks and construction were built several decades ago. You know, even today, if you look at the construction, you know, people still get the rock, this one, and then they get buy the wood and make the doors, windows, and all that. But is it possible to standardize these things? And also, you have the buildings which consume a lot of power. Right from paint to everything affects your power. So can you make green buildings? Can you use less resources? Can you use less power to maintain your buildings and so on? New designs, technologies and management models are available to upgrade the existing ones and to build new ones. So this can be, if you basically look at the ecosystem model for a smart building, smart network, and then the innovations that are possible, you can design the whole thing. This requires process orientation, modularization, standardization, and so on. So, to conclude this, you know, here we have the SAS framework holistically models all the factors that interact with the supply chain. So, in one page, when you look at the SES model, in one page, you have the entire model, all the factors that you need to consider. That's a big help. You may know them, all of them separately, but putting all the experts together at one place, at one table to discuss, that can produce fireworks. So it has several applications in improving the investment climate, policy breaking, re-engineering the companies, developing infrastructure and several others. And while going through the book, one can map the company, village or city and can visualize opportunities for it. So if you can look at every organization or the human being or the work that you are doing as a bundle of services, then this will be helpful. Thank you.